Not long ago, this was Jean, a file clerk in her hometown. But her mind was far, far away, in a world of travel, new friends, exciting jobs. A wonderful world that she found in the Women's Army Corps. Now she's an information specialist assigned to San Francisco. Fascinating city, interesting job, lucky girl. A girl who found a wonderful world of opportunity in the Women's Army Corps.
Can you qualify? I don't think I went into the Navy with any expectations. I wanted to get out of where I was. That was the only thing I was basically looking at. And I was 19 years old, and I wanted away from where I was. I wanted to go do something else. And I just really felt like it was time to get away from my family too, as far as having them always there and always, you know, so much a part of my life. I just really needed to get out on my own.
My interests stemmed from wanting to travel. And not wanting to go back to Chicago or stay in Pittsburgh. So the travel was my main interest.
Being on a ship, and that's what the Navy is, going out to sea, and I'd be a real sailor, and, you know, the whole concept was exciting to me. You know, because my dad did it, my brother's doing it, and I was gonna do it.
And I went down and talked to a recruiter and got everything filled out and all of their forms that ask you whether or not you have homosexual tendencies or not. And you just kind of look at the question and answer, no, of course. My first duty station was in San Diego. And while I was there, the Women at Sea program opened up. And it was on a volunteer-only basis in the beginning. They did not want to force any women to go on board because they wanted to just make it work. And I put in for it. Some of the men were okay with it. A lot of them were not. The guys had to change how they did things. And it was just something, I think, that needed to be worked with.
We would come on board to the ship, go into our berthing, and written up over the berthing was Dyke's Den. So there was some harassment as far as that's concerned.
I was on a ship for, I think, a month before the investigation the investigation started. So it wasn't very long at all.
The investigation on the homosexuality, that was very intimidating because that came so quickly. We didn't know what had hit us.
I had gone to Long Beach to go to a doctor's appointment. And when I got back, everybody was talking. And they were pulling women in one by one into staterooms to be questioned by NIS officers.
Basically, what they wanted us to do was sign a piece of paper and say goodbye.
One of the reasons I went to law school was this issue. So when I went to work for the ACLU, I had it in my mind that maybe someday I'd get a chance to do something about this. And I hadn't been there very long, actually. I think I'd been on staff maybe 6 months when a call came in. And a counselor came running across the hallway and said, "We have a person on the telephone, and she says that her daughter is friends with some people on a ship who are being discharged for homosexuality." And I can remember just sitting back in my chair. I knew what it was. I knew what was happening. And I sort of took a breath to sort of calm myself because my heart got really excited. And I went across the hallway and I picked up the phone. And the woman told me that there were 24 women on a ship that were being discharged because they were lesbians. And could I do anything about it? And I remember what I said. I said, "You bet."
One of my accusations was that I had hardcore lesbian pornography under my rack.
One of the accusations against me was for giving someone a back rub when their back hurt.
I don't like perfume, and someone was supposed to have sprayed perfume on me, and I ran and washed it right off.
They're trying to discharge me for reading a sex magazine, you know? I was accused of leaving the ship with one of the females and then coming back on board later on during the night with hickeys covering my neck.
Why do you have to pry into someone's sex life when they show you that their work performance is the only concern that you should have? But the Navy contends that you belong to me. I belong to nobody but myself and God.
Out of 500 crew members, at least 40 people were interviewed by Naval Investigative Services on the day they came on board the ship. And what they would do is they would ask them what the rumors were of homosexuality. And they would write that down. But instead of writing it down as a rumor, they would write it down as fact.
They were our shipmates. They drank with us, laughed with us, partied with us, played with us, cried with us. You're on a ship, you get intimate with people as far as your conversation, and you were betrayed.
I look at the people that are making the statements and I just can't see it. To look at them and you sit there and you just wonder what must be going through their head.
Were they telling the truth?
In my opinion, no.
It's a witch hunt. And anyone, innocent, guilty, or whatever, could be caught up in it. It doesn't matter.
Ever since what Franklin Delano Roosevelt formed the queer catching units in the Navy years ago, they had been massively successful in discharging homosexuals simply faced with rumor allegation.
I felt like it was a big invasion of my privacy, and I felt like all the good work that I did while I was in the Navy didn't count. What counted was what I did on Liberty on my own time, what people thought was going on. I didn't like it at all.
We were all herded to one of the hospitals in Long Beach, and we all had to have psychiatric evaluations done. It was crazy. It was really crazy, and I felt like an animal or something.
I remember the meeting we had with Susan McGreevy when we first got together and met each other, and I didn't know what I was getting myself into.
It was a small California-style bungalow, and the women were in very tight clusters of friends all throughout the room and the dining room, and the fear in that room was absolutely overwhelming.
I remember everybody sitting like this, you know, really interested in what Susan had to say.
When we closed the door, I interviewed each alone. Many of them cried when the others couldn't see them.
She saw what was going on, and I think she really wanted to defend it and fight it in a way that would allow everybody to have their rights. A lot of the women were not lesbians.
This was not a case where everybody stood up and said, "I'm gay, and don't discharge me." My basic view was this was a case which was about human sexuality and the right to have one's sexual habits remain private.
It was hard for me a lot of times to fight it with the fact that it's no one's business. I agree with that point of view in a lot of ways because I don't feel that it should make a difference. But for me personally, the issue of being a lesbian in the military had been something that I had always wanted to fight.
Women were not allowed to be sexual. And more importantly, they weren't allowed to be sexual in a way which they were non-available to the male personnel on that ship. And there was a whole lot of that aimed at them, too.
The guys that would come up to you and say, you know, or would sit there and say, "Well, yeah, we'll just kneel down between my legs, you know, and we'll let somebody walk in on us, and then you'll be cleared." You know, and you're going, "Wait a minute, I don't have to do that to clear me. I haven't done anything wrong in the first place." Susan McGreevy's tactics were to immediately go through the press and to basically fight this through the media, which I feel was the best thing that we could have ever done.
I think this business of mass queer hunting on the part of Naval Investigative Service, which has a whole division which is funded by taxpayers' dollars to do nothing but queer hunt. They open people's letters. The waste of human talent is unbelievable to me. One of the Navy's tactics was to wear us out physically. So instead of holding the hearings in the air-conditioned courtroom that was 400 yards down the way, they put us in a very closed cabin like this. And yet it was in August. It was in the middle of one of the hottest heat waves I can remember in Los Angeles. So that the temperature in the cabin, I would guess, as it moved towards noon, was getting up to 110, maybe more. We would just be sitting in pools of perspiration.
I remember that it was my time to go. I remember being a small room, dark, a round table with lots of men in uniform with accolades and gold. I recall that I was scared to death because it was my career that was on the line. The only thing I remember is the one witness. The question that they asked him was whether they knew of any men that had had sex with Seaman Underwood. He answered yes, one, and they asked who, and he said me. He may have in his mind, thought that he had sex with me, but he did not. But that's what saved me. They recommended retention under that testimony.
We weren't very positive going in. We didn't feel very, very positive about the whole thing at all.
They started the hearings at 7 in the morning, and they ran them till 11 at night. And they refused to allow any break between each plaintiff's case as they came up. So we would have to defend one and then move immediately into the next one, into the next one, into the next one. I believe to some extent that tactic worked, at least as far as Alicia's case went, because 3 days before Alicia's hearing, we suddenly received notice that there was going to be a witness whom I didn't know anything about. And it was a young man who worked in the boiler room. He was going to testify that he had seen Alicia and Wendy having sex down in the boiler room of this ship on a gangway with steam coming from every which direction while the ship was at sea.
I don't know really what I felt. I can't recall back to that moment. I think I have a mental block.
The likelihood of a woman of African-American descent having been on a ship 45 days, having sex on a gangway in the boiler room of a ship was, in my opinion, about zero. It smelled of racism.
I was not surprised that 8 out of 9 African-American women were charged. It seems typical of government in certain situations where you have blacks involved.
I can only say that the person who testified against them would not, in a normal courtroom, have had any credibility whatsoever. We were unable to get the evidence that we needed to impeach him.
Someone was going to fall, and we sort of had the feeling that it was going to be us.
Today, a board of Navy officers found 18-year-old Alicia Harris guilty of homosexual activity while a sailor on board the USS Norton Sound.
There was no homosexual acts on the ship ever. I'm not a homosexual, I'm straight. And I figured that they just had to start with somebody. I don't think it was fair.
Alicia Harris never became the college graduate, never fulfilled her plans for her life. That's a loss. That's a significant loss.
I felt betrayed because my intentions going into the Navy were good intentions, and I had plans to do well, and it was like all of those dreams they were blown away. Everything just happened just crazy, just out of nowhere. It was like darkness just came over instantly.
they finally attained a victory of sorts with Wendy and Alicia's being discharged from the service. And they knew that they didn't have any comparable evidence in the remaining hearings, so they pulled up anchor and they went into retreat. They just dropped them. They said, drop them for insufficient evidence.
The day that I found out the charges were dropped against me, they held a press conference at the ACLU. For me, somehow in my mind, I thought, well, now I can say it. And when I was in the attorney's office and I was in the woman who's in charge of the American Civil Liberties Union down in Los Angeles, and I asked him, I said, can I now? And they both just said to me at the same time, it's like, no, Carol. If you come out now as a lesbian, they'll just bring the charges back against you again.
I'm glad that it's over, or for as much of it that's over as far as it is now. I would have liked to have gone through with my board, though. You know, I feel that it's like just the satisfaction of going through it. I don't feel they would have kicked me out. I don't feel they had enough to kick me out with. Therefore, you know, it's kind of almost a letdown, too, in a lot of ways.
I'm real happy that it's all over. I just wish that, like Carol said, that we would have been able to go forth with our boards, because they don't have any evidence against us, and I don't think they had any against Alicia or Wendy either. And I just wish that things would be different for them.
After the hearing, we all went about our business. The accusations were still flying around. The stigma was still there. The atmosphere on board the ship was no longer safe when you went out to sea. It was a little bit more than I could take. I had wanted to be transferred off that particular ship. I was denied a transfer, and I believe that the Navy felt that my attitude was no longer sufficient for them. I was no longer happy in there, they felt, and as a convenience of the government, I needed to be discharged honorably. I felt like my whole world had been taken away. All my dreams and goals had been stolen from me. It was a tragedy for me. I had to go back home to what? With little training. The most training that I had gotten out of the service was how to defend myself from lesbian accusations. I was out in California, 3,000 miles from my home. I was lost. That was it. Felt my life was ruined at 23 years old.
I'm going to stay right on the Norton Sound. I'm not moving. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying on that ship.
I have about 45 days left, and right now I don't really know.
After I went through the investigation, I think within myself I realized that there is no way I would ever allow anybody to do this to me again. I really feel that it should have come down to, you know, what my job performance was. And it didn't. They wanted to bring things in that had never happened even on board the ship. So for me, there was no question in my mind, there's no way I was going to stay in.
We had a meeting right after it ended, and I can still remember those women snapping to for me and saying how proud they were. They were so proud of themselves.
Learned a lot about life going through that. In a way, I can probably thank them. Because I'll never have that happen to me again.
I guess I look at a lot of situations in which the government takes an active part, and it's just a confirmation of what I went through, because so many other people are going through a lot of things, and where the government interferes and they preach justice, but there really is no justice.
In the Navy, yes, you can sail the seven seas.